Akili sio syllable sana, usi stress, usi digress, kuwa mdiverse. What's up, beautiful people? My name is Willie Oeba and you're watching Grapevine.
The Black and White Affair is an elevated consumer experience centered on three pillars: food, music and fashion. Now that was a brilliant way to piga a sherehe out of Nairobi. Mama There's Fena Gitu also graced the stage, taking the vibe to a whole nother level.
Kwaijani, I've realized losing someone you had is sad.
There is no experience that beats live performances, and Mufasa the Poet brought a different kind of vibe to the stage.
I've left earth every time I have performed. Proof that I cannot always be grounded.
The boy band's chemistry on stage is unmatched, and all they give is immaculate vibes.
Good afternoon. This is Lunchtime News. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. My name is Jackie Wimbiro. Sign language interpreter is Susan Thuku. And to kick us off, we'll be crossing over to the corridors of justice, whereby the judiciary has warned politicians. The judiciary has warned politicians against giving false promises to their supporters about resolving land issues that require legal procedures. Environment and Lands Court Judge Lady Justice Millicent Odeni, judiciary said the numerous land cases in the coast have remained unresolved because the victims do not follow due processes when seeking justice.
Speaking during a cleanup exercise at Mayungu in Malindi to mark the 10th anniversary of the establishment of the Environment and Lands Court, Kilifi North MP Owen Baya accused the judiciary and lawyers in Malindi of being behind the injustices in Chembe Kibabamuche and Kilifi Jimba settlement schemes, which have had controversies for years.
Then they moved the adjudication again to a scheme so that they can give their friends and big people. So Chembe Kibabamuche is here with us. It's a big animal, a big elephant in the room that needs to be solved. The biggest problem and impediment to the Chembe Kibabamuche is the judiciary, and especially the court in Malindi. I have said, and I'm on record to say, even in parliament, that no local ever has won a case in Chembe Kibabamuche. No local has ever won a case in Chembe Kibabamuche. The people who win cases here are the people, the foreigners who come, lodge cases, and they win those cases. How come in a judicial system where no local has ever won, what is the problem? Is the problem the people, the lawyers, or the judiciary? But there must be a problem. And I want to tell the judiciary, they are here to dispense justice, not to allow people to buy justice. And what I see in Malindi here, those with money get justice. Those without money don't get justice. The locals don't have money, so they will never get justice. And that is the story of Chembe Kibabamuche.
Judge Lady Justice Millicent Odeni, however, said some of the land cases in Malindi were controversial. She said social justice, as advocated by the area MP, was supposed to be both ways and emphasized the need for politicians to tell their people the right thing.
Land is a very emotive issue here, all over the country. So during elections, you find that people invade private land. And sometimes it is perpetrated by the same people who want to defend their rights. So tell them the right thing.
Kwale ELC Judge Justice Adria Dena urged the locals to cooperate with the judiciary to enhance dispensation of justice.
Tusipoteze mashamba yetu kwa sababu tumejikosesha nafasi ya kuja kotini nasi kusema dukuduku zetu kupinga yale yameletwa kotini, na sisi tuweze kusikiza pande zote mbili ndio tuweze kuweka mizani na kuangalia haki iko wapi.
And now in other news, we cross over to Huduma Center at the GPO here in Nairobi, where Public Service Cabinet Secretary Aisha Juma was earlier drawn touring the facility as well as inspecting services at the institution. Let's listen in.
Revamped training program on Huduma, Kenya standards and customer service excellence to capacitate staff with the required skills to serve customers better. As part of the Head of State Directive, launch a tree planting program through Huduma Center, adopt a county forest with a target to plant 500 million trees in the next 5 years. And going forward, the ministry will expand Huduma Kenya Service Delivery Program to ensure no Kenyan is left behind in accessing public services. The ministry will continue to find innovative ways to bring services closer to the people, especially through adoption of technology in conformity to Kenya Kwanza Manifesto on digital services. Thank you.
Question.
Yeah, kama mbili tatu hivi.
With the high cost of living, any plans to review the salaries for civil servants?
Well, that was Public Service Cabinet Secretary Aisha Juma at the GPO Huduma Center here in Nairobi. She has stated that the Ministry of Public Service will be launching a tree planting program or initiative rather, as well as expand service delivery across the country. We shall be keeping you updated in our subsequent bulletins. For now, we move on. Blood donation as a voluntary procedure has been used over the years to save lives. It turns out that donating blood does not just benefit recipients, there are health benefits for donors too. Apart from the psychological satisfaction that one gets when donating blood, do Kenyans really know the other benefits they get? Pauline Nasimeo sheds more light on the benefits of a blood donor get.
Blood donation has been associated with different slogans over the years. Quotes like save a life, donate blood. Save a life, give blood. And donating blood gives us a chance to save a life. This year, during the World Blood Donor Day, the slogan was donating blood is an act of solidarity. Join the effort and save lives. All these aim at drawing people's attention to the role that voluntary blood donations play in saving lives and enhancing solidarity within communities. And just like a familiar chorus song, Kenyans do understand the need of donating blood.
I came here today because I feel someone out there needs my blood, and I have enough to share. I feel it's okay to give.
I feel there's a need to make an impact in other people's life, and one of the ways of making an impact in other people's life is by donating blood. That means the blood you donate can go and save a life somewhere.
I personally love donating blood because I believe it's helping someone else, and doing good by others means doing good by God.
However, are they aware of the health benefits they get when donating blood?
I usually just come to give. I don't think of myself while doing it.
I guess the satisfaction that comes with the fact, with the knowing, that my blood can help somebody somewhere.
Probably if they are, you can tell me.
Majority of Kenyans do not understand the benefits they themselves get when they donate blood. Most of them know that it's all about helping another person. But this is not just about helping another person. This is also about you. Tokens of refreshments and reimbursement are not the only benefits one gets for donating blood. There are health benefits too for the donor, as Dr. Esther Akinyi explains.
Blood donation can also be therapeutic, meaning that it can be treatment for some conditions. There are some people who have conditions such as, it's known as hemochromatosis, where they have excess iron in the body. When you donate, then the excess iron is able to be offloaded, and now you have normal iron stores.
Even though you may seem healthy, going about your daily routine with ease, there may be diseases developing in you without your knowledge. Such diseases can be detected through free health screening that a blood donor gets.
Before donation, there's always some questions that people are asked. There are some vital signs that are taken. There is weight that is taken. Your blood pressure is taken together with your pulse. And also your HB levels can also be taken. When that is done to you, then you are able even to get to know the state of your health. You're able to get to know even some things that you had not discovered about yourself, in terms of maybe probably you have a blood pressure that is now developing, and that way you can be able to seek medical attention early.
Donation of blood before surgery for one's use can be beneficial to a donor when they are facing a life-threatening situation.
There is something known as autologous blood donation, and this is where the person themselves donate their own blood a few weeks before probably a scheduled surgery, so that during that surgery, when they require that blood or any other situation where they require that blood, then it can be added to them. So you see, this becomes a benefit to that person. Yes, they donated it earlier on, but when they're in that situation that is life-threatening, that they require blood, they can be able to get their own blood. So it reduces the risk of any blood-borne infections that can be got from any other donated blood.
So now you know, donating blood not only helps the recipient by saving their lives, but also has several health benefits for the donor. Pauline Nasimiu for Channel One News, Nairobi.
And now in other news, online purchases account for less than 2% of total retail sales, and e-businesses are being advised to leverage on the festive season shopping rush to establish consumer trust. Jumia CEO Juan Seco believes value-added experiences through seamless transactions and prompt delivery are the top priority for most online shoppers.
Kenya has the third largest e-commerce market in Africa, after South Africa and Nigeria. However, compared to the US and China, where e-commerce sales stands at 15% and 25% respectively, Kenya's e-commerce transactions still remains dismal.
We've been very cognizant of, you know, the situation, the economic reality right now, right? The inflation, the fuel prices, you know, the dollar shortage for some of our vendors.
Jumia CEO Juan Seco says this low turnout may be as a result of high delivery costs, which he says could be remedied through subscriptions and discounts to woo in customers. In addition, he says, the belief that online platforms are only meant for electronic gadgets is negatively impacting the sale of other consumer goods, especially perishables such as food delivery and on-demand vegetables.
As the supply chains have improved versus last year, people are going back to buying, you know, electronics a lot because they see now that those prices are making more sense, or they see that stock available on the platform, so they go for it. So now we're really covering a 360.
Actually, our target is huge because we're providing a very super offer in this time around.
They note that online sales have been at an all-time low this year, despite the economic turnaround due to constraints in the global supply chain. Speaking during the launch of Jumia's Black Friday, Seco projected that the coming few weeks could provide a turnaround for e-commerce platforms due to the festive times, which is the peak season for the sector.
It's a normal, I think, evolution of people feeling comfortable to buy online. As people shop online one time, two times, they'll become more comfortable with it, and it becomes part of their natural habits.
Hibak Said for Lunchtime News.
And Mumia's sugar factory workers are calling on the miller's management to settle their salary arrears. The Mumia's Sugar Factory Workers Association say the farm is yet to pay creditors despite the pledge made before resumption of sugar milling. In town, the workers called for an audience with the management to address some of their concerns. Let's take a look.
Sisi tulilipwa pesa?
Hapana.
Kuacha kazi?
Hapana.
Utaendaje kuklaim haki yako? Sisi bado tuko kazini kwa sababu we have never been sacked.
It's wrong for the government kunyamaza ya kwamba watu wanaangaika. Tulichanga pesa yetu ya retirement, lakini mpaka saa hizi tunaangaika kama watu wenye hawakuwahi fanya kazi na serikali imebaki silent.
Tunataka vile uli promise kwamba you want to pump in 10 billion to revive Mumia Sugar Company. Tafadhali ukuje, hawa watu wote wako nyuma yangu walikupigia kura ili uweze kuamusha Mumia Sugar Company.
And now we cross over to the defense headquarters in Nairobi, where the handing over ceremony is currently underway, with former Cabinet Secretary Eugene Wamalwa handing over the ministry to incoming Cabinet Secretary Aden Duale. This is what they had to say earlier on. Let's listen in.
Manufacturing, as you know, we have a shipyard. As Kenya, we are able to manufacture our own ships, and it's a great stride we have made in manufacturing and industrialization of our country, as well as contributing to the food security of our country. So we want to wish them well as they receive a new leader, and their role goes beyond, as I say, the traditional role of security. We'd like to see them do more to contribute to our national development. As I leave, I want to wish them well, wish their families well, and also wish those who are outside our borders, serving in Somalia, those who are serving in DRC and other missions, peace support missions beyond our borders, we wish them well, and I wish to welcome my brother to come and now officially take over as I have handed over, and say a few words before we release you. Thank you very much, and God bless you. Karibu, karibu.
Thank you, CS Wamalwa, for graciously welcoming me and the rest of the team to the defense headquarters. And on the onset, I want to thank His Excellency the President and the Commander-in-Chief for the great honor to appoint me as the defense CS, and I want to assure him and the country at large of my full commitment in achieving the duties and responsibilities of this office. I also want to thank the CDF and the entire KDF fraternity for their warm welcome and reception they have accorded to me, not only today, but the day just before my vetting. And I am sure with their good contribution, I did very well on my vetting day. I wish to state that I will always consult and get the wise counsel from the top leadership of KDF on handling key issues related to my mandate, and I expect a smooth working relationship during my tenure as a CS. I also want to thank the outgoing CS of Defense, my brother Eugene Wamalwa, for his wise counsel before and this morning, as well as his dedication and commitment in serving this country before me, like many, many other ministers. In accordance with Article 231, Sabbatical 3A, B, and C, we shall defend and protect our sovereignty and territorial integrity of our country. We shall assist and cooperate with other authorities in situation of emergency and disaster, of what we are, our KDF is doing during this time of the drought. And we shall deploy troops to restore peace and order in any part of the country affected by unrest.
Well, those live pictures were earlier on at the defense headquarters, where former Cabinet Secretary Eugene Wamalwa handed over the ministry to Cabinet Secretary Aden Duale. And now we move on. The ravaging drought situation in Kajiado County has seen the rural urban migration of cattle, which are now roaming freely in towns in the region. Residents say the animals have formed an interesting pattern of roaming around, waiting to feed on waste in the towns. Let's take a look.
Cattle crisscrossing the roads feeding on garbage have become a new sight, especially in Kitengela and Isinya towns in Kajiado County. Ordinarily, farmers do not allow their cattle to feed on garbage to avoid health complications occasioned by polythene bugs. However, the farmers have now been left with no alternative.
Ati huu hakuna chakula cha mifugo kabisa. So inabidi wale wafugaji walete sokoni angalau mahali kuna ule uchafu ili wale ng'ombe wapate chakula.
Na tunaomba sana hata wale wako karibu na nyasi wakubali hata ng'ombe hizi ziigie.
Traders in markets say prices of the emaciated cattle have sunk to the lowest, with adult cattle selling for as low as 2,000 shillings from 70,000 shillings. A recent survey by the county government of Kajiado revealed that 450,000 cattle are on the verge of succumbing to hunger due to drought. Meanwhile, Kenya Internally Displaced Persons Organization is calling upon governors to scale up relief aid programs in the sub-counties to alleviate suffering among communities ravaged by drought. Kidpo patron Peter Tena noted millions of Kenyans are undergoing untold suffering in the face of the prevailing drought.
Mataifa yote ya ulimwengu wanajua inchi yetu inakumbwa na njaa. Tunaomba wafadhili makanisa na donors na well wishers mahali popote wako. Isizingatiwe tu ati kusemekana Northeastern. Hapana.
The organization is also urging county bosses in the South and North Rift regions to allocate funds for irrigation programs in high agricultural potential areas and expand disaster management kits as part of mitigation measures against the plague.
Zile county zote zile 47 magovernors hata nao wachangie sehemu fulani ya kusaidia national government kuweza kutenga rasilimali kadhaa ziweze kuwafikia wamama wetu wapate kuweka mkate na chakula kwa meza.
And hundreds of Indian faithful converged in Thika, Kiambu County for special prayers for rain as the effect of drought continued being felt in parts of the country. The faithful prayed for the favor of rain and called on Kenyans to help those affected by drought.
Need rain because the drought has really affected our country, and we're also praying to Lord Swaminarayan for the peace of the country.
Jacqueline Masharia for Lunchtime News.
Health Cabinet Secretary Wafula Nakhumicha has taken over officially from her predecessor Mutahi Kagwe at Afya House. Nakhumicha, who was sworn in as Health Minister last week, expressed gratitude for having been appointed to head the docket. The new CS lauded her predecessor for great strides in health provision nationally during his tenure of office.
I took it seriously, the development of Chanjo that Sitenei and his team have done, all the things that have been done to ensure that we have moved from where we were to where we are now. Madam CS, there is a lot of work going on. There are a lot of initiatives that are currently happening, all the way from the manufacturing of vaccines in our country via BioVax, which is a new organization, to the formation of the National Public Health Institutes, so that we can be more efficient in handling diseases that come to us. And all this work has been done by the people who are sitting around here and others who are not here.
Yeah, I have noted that, colleagues, and we look forward to ensuring that people are rightfully placed and we are rightfully working together to achieve the objectives that we have been given. I want to take this opportunity to thank His Excellency Dr. William Samoei Ruto for seeing it fit to give me this chance to serve in this position. We are planted in places in different seasons for a reason. And I want to call upon my colleagues and to call upon everybody else within the ministry that as we land, as we are planted here for this season, let us make a difference.
Well, that report brings us to our first break here on Lunchtime News. Don't go too far. We'll be right back with more news.
Do you have a new story to share with KBC? Get in touch swiftly on email news@kbc.co.ke or call 0723-892-654 or 0734-780-124.
To get Change Your Thinking Skiza Tune, dial *811*961#.
When you change the quality of your thinking, you change the quality of your life. Sometimes instantly, just as positive words can make someone calm, smile or laugh, your thoughts will react to the world in real time. So, change the quality of your thinking.
Dial *811*961#. *811*961#.
This week on Tech on Tech, we tell you how legal meets tech.
Our application is called Legal Tech Services. It's a web-based application, and what it does is allow for the exchange of legal services.
In tech news, e-insurance startup bags $1.2 billion in Series A Drive, and internationally, Elon Musk presents Optimus. This is a humanoid robot. More details in our Tech News Roundup.
Join me, Stephanie Ayete, and Grace Gedaga as we serve you with only the best tech updates the world over.
Tech on Tech every Monday at 10:30 p.m. on KBC Channel 1. Stay tuned.
At KBC Channel 1, we put people at the heart of events with our captivating weekly news features. Every day, we are breaking new grounds with informative, entertaining, and inspiring human interest stories. On Mondays, 9 p.m., we have The Cabinet. Tuesday, 9 p.m., we get inside the barracks for military tales. We delve in the world of cinemas and theater each Wednesday night. For the young and industrious, make a date with us every Thursday at 9 p.m. Fridays are dedicated for my culture.
Welcome back. Now, let's proceed. Dozens of people have died after a pedestrian suspension bridge collapsed in India's Gujarat state. Elsewhere, Russia has launched massive missile strikes across Ukraine, including the capital Kyiv, causing power and water outages. Details in our international news roundup.
Dozens of people have died after a pedestrian suspension bridge collapsed in India's Gujarat state. At least 177 people have been rescued so far. This is according to officials. The rescue teams are still trying to recover bodies from the river. Most of the bodies being recovered are those of women and children. Prasanna Kumar, the commander of the National Disaster Response Force, said they would continue the operation until everything takes place South Korea's Prime Minister Han Duck-soo has promised to conduct a thorough investigation into the accident that occurred as crowds thronged Itaewon, a popular nightlife district of Seoul. The victims, mostly in their 20s, had thronged the area for Halloween. It was the first outdoor no-mask Halloween event with no limit on numbers since the COVID-19 pandemic. And Russia has launched massive missile strikes across Ukraine, including the capital Kiev, causing power and water outages, Ukrainian officials say. At least two blasts were reported in Kiev. In the northeastern city of Kharkiv, critical infrastructure facilities were hit, the local authorities said. The strikes come after Russia blamed Ukraine for a drone attack on its Black Sea fleet in the annexed Crimea. On Monday, missile strikes were also reported in the central Vinnytsia region, as well as Dnipropetrovsk and Zaporizhia in the southeast, and Lviv in western Ukraine.
And now let's take a look at news-making headlines in the business world, where coffee farmers in Trans Nzoia, Bungoma and Kakamega counties are set to benefit from a 3 billion shilling coffee cherry advance revolving fund to boost production. The farmers in the leading coffee producing counties have started receiving the funds under the 2020 government-funded kitty. Let's take a look.
First, most farmers depended on traditional farming methods which have negatively affected output and quality of produce. The 3 billion shillings kit was provided in 2020 for coffee farmers to borrow against cherry, delivered in their factories at 20 shillings per kilogram as they wait for their coffee to be sold. Speaking during a sensitization exercise at Mumonyonzo Coffee Factory in Lukiani, Kakamega County, Western Region New Kenya Planters Cooperative Union Officer Moses Wandwazi said the government has put measures to ensure farmers benefit from diversification in agriculture. He added that the essence of the fund is to cushion coffee farmers from high bank interests and SACCOs who charge over 10% compared to a one-off charge of 3%.
So far tunaya experience kwa kulima wengi ambao wanakuja kwa kilimo cha kahawa. Hata kumekuwa na changamoto ya kupata miche kwa wakulima wengine, na tuna encourage tu cooperative societies ziweze kutengeneza hizo miche ili wakulima waweze kupata miche za kupanda. So far mambo ya coffee cherry advance revolving fund, wakulima wamebenefit from Bungoma and Trans Nzoia counties. Leo tukapa hivi in Kakamega county pia kwa sensitize wakulima, na tuko hopeful from next week wakulima wataanza kuaccess hizi pesa kwa sababu tumewaachia forms.
Sheila Wambui, a KPCU technical officer, said the government is working with other stakeholders to manage the effect of climate change in agriculture.
Kama mafunzo ambayo tumeleta hapa leo, hii pesa ikifikia kila mkulima, mkulima pia aweze kuaccess subsidized farm inputs, kwa sababu kitu ambayo inalemea wakulima wengi ni hiyo high cost of production. Unapata anatumia pesa mingi kununua madawa, pesa mingi kuaccess advances, lakini serikali ikiingilia iweze kumreducea hii cost na tuendelee kuwataftia soko mzuri hapa locally kwa nchi na pia direct sales kwa ngambo.
Equity Bank has organized a trade mission that will take place in Tanzania and Kenya as part of implementing the Africa Recovery and Resilience Plan. The trade mission will capacitate, coordinate, and champion business connections between the US, Tanzania, and Kenya, targeting, among others, ICT, infrastructure, health, agriculture, and renewable energy sectors.
Nairobi and Zanzibar are strategic in the East African regional bloc, making them attractive to investors and exporters.
It has a highly skilled labor force and an English-speaking population, which makes it very easy for U.S. companies to tap into the workforce here.
In 2021, the United States exported more than $60 million worth of agricultural produce to Kenya and $6.9 million worth to Tanzania. During the week-long trade mission organized by Equity Bank, U.S. participants are expected to meet potential importers, processors, and distributors from Kenya and Tanzania, as well as from other East African nations.
This plan is basically focused on implementing, it's an implementation plan to capacitate, connect, coordinate, and finance Africa value chains to transform Africa's wealth. And why is this important?
Equity Bank is riding on the success of the Kenya DRC trade mission, which saw over 300 Kenyans travel the DRC to explore investment opportunities in November last year to implement its Africa Recovery and Resilience Plan.
We have what we call commercial partnerships. This is where we try to, as much as possible, when we are working with smallholders, when we are working with the outgrowers and farmers, we try as much as possible to link them with the market, whether that market is local or international, so that then when they are producing, they are very clear about where they will offload their produce.
ICT, infrastructure, health, agriculture and renewable energy sectors are most attractive to U.S. investors who are keen on diversifying their investment portfolios in Africa. Regina Manyara reporting for Lunchtime News.
Countries in Europe have eased rules for the banks that manage the trading of their government debts to help them cope with challenging market conditions. Netherlands and Belgium have loosened various market-making obligations, dictating how actively these banks should trade their debt. Details of these and more news from around the globe.
As the European Central Bank unwinds years of buying the region's debt, the war in Ukraine, an energy shock, and turmoil in Britain are making investors wary of loading up on government bonds. Debt managers are adjusting to a less liquid and more volatile market. France, Spain, and Finland's rules are already structured to automatically take account of market tensions. Debt offices where obligations adapt automatically said attempts to enforce predetermined bid-ask spreads in volatile markets would discourage primary dealers from providing liquidity and cause more volatility. Elsewhere, oil prices in China have plunged following weaker than expected factory activity. Data in China shows concerns that its widening COVID-19 curbs will curtail demand. Brent crude dropped by 63 cents to $95.14 a barrel, even as some of the largest U.S. oil producers on Friday signaled that productivity and volume gains in the Permian Basin, the nation's top shale field, are slowing. The warnings came just as U.S. oil exports rose by 3.4%. Finally, Elon Musk has denied a news report that he plans to lay off Twitter workers before the start of next month to avoid having to make payouts. Replying to a Twitter user asking about the report, he said, "This is false." Last week, Musk completed his $44 billion takeover of the social media platform after months of legal wrangling. The buyout saw the exit of the firm's top bosses, including its chief executive officer, chairman, and finance chief. Musk said the Bird app will revise how it verifies its users.
The Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission has summoned two members of the Vision 2030 Delivery Board to record statements at the Integrity Center over claims of irregular recruitment at the Vision 2030 Delivery Secretariat. EACC Chief Executive Officer has directed Vision 2030 Delivery Board Chairperson Jane Karuko and Rita Kakashi to appear before the Anti-Corruption Commission on Tuesday, November 1st, and Wednesday, November 2nd, this year, respectively, to record their statements over the matter.
Allegations on irregular recruitment at Vision 2030 Delivery Secretariat. To further facilitate its investigations, the Anti-Corruption Commission is seeking to interview and record statements of Jane Karuko, who is the Vision 2030 Delivery Board Chairperson. Karuko has been invited to appear before the Commission on Tuesday, November 1st, 2022, at 9 a.m.
Now in other news, Wiper party leader Kalonzo Musyoka says leaders who want to work with President William Ruto are free to do so. Speaking in Makueni, Kalonzo said he will remain loyal in opposition as he repositions himself for the task ahead. The Wiper leader, however, took issue with the manner subsidies on key commodities were scrapped, saying it is accelerating poverty in the country.
GMO. Kama saratani inasumbua wa Kenya, mnaleta chakula ingine wazungu wenyewe hawataki kukula. Na nimesema viongozi wa makanisa, take a position. When you are doing gene transfer, you're interfering with God's ability to create human beings.
Moving on, the government will work with multinationals and the private sector to mentor and build the capacity of small businesses to support their growth. Cooperatives and MSMEs Development Cabinet Secretary Simon Chelugui says ahead of the operationalization of the 50 billion shilling hustler fund, there is need to equip small business operators with the necessary skills to tap the fund and improve their resilience.
We are encouraging our corporates through the CSR to also mentor and grow the upcoming business corporates. These small and micro enterprises are sometimes producers, suppliers of the big corporates. Say, for example, if we can support a farmer in Narok producing wheat or tobacco in Western Kenya, that becomes the raw material to BAT. That becomes the raw material to Kenya Breweries, a big corporate. And I would be encouraging, by persuasion, these corporates to support government in training small and micro enterprises.
The government of Kenya, as we've briefed you, has developed various policies and programs and initiatives to support SMEs, whether it is on training, whether it is on infrastructure development, the Juakali sites we've talked about in the past, the CIDCs.
But there is still a lot of unfinished business. In fact, some of it pending in the cabinet that you, as we have explained to you, that you'll be able to have an opportunity to take it to the next level. So this is really your day. We just want to thank you and wish you the very best.
In other news, hundreds of teenage girls from various schools in Seme sub-county of Kisumu County have benefited from free sanitary towels and other assorted menstrual health products. The charity event dubbed Mashinani Empowerment. The teenagers and boys also benefited from expert career talk from various guests. The event was organized by Miss Humanitarian Kenya and her friends. Achela Simon with the details.
Behind the cheerful faces and laughter that reverberates the air lies the never-ending problem of lack of basic necessities of menstrual health amongst many teenage girls in rural and informal settlements across the country.
When we reach out to the village, especially the village girls, there's usually that inferiority, that you feel scared talking about your menstrual hygiene or menstrual cycle. So we are telling these girls that it's a natural process. They should embrace it.
Nimefurahia kwa siku ya leo kwa yale changamoto ambayo wale wasichana wanapitia kwa kiasi leo vimetatuliwa.
To break the vicious circle, players in the sector now want both national and county governments to act fast and put in place policies that will ensure sanitary towels can easily be accessed by the girls.
But if we could pass policies that could put at the forefront in the aspect of reducing the prices of the sanitary towels, it will be very key, because especially to the marginalized or the girls in the village, they cannot afford 100 shillings every month. We can easily walk to a supermarket and come out with a sanitary towel. Some of us even use tampon, which we don't find it to be a big issue. But the girl child down there in the village, it's a big deal to get 100 shillings.
12-year-old Miss Humanitarian Kenya is also encouraging well-wishers to continue bridging the gap, even as policy implementers find a lasting solution to the problem.
Many girls do not have sanitary towels. So some girls cannot afford sanitary towels because they come from vulnerable families. So today we are giving them pads to keep them comfortable in both schools and home.
She spoke as she witnessed the distribution of sanitary towels to various teenagers across Seme sub-county in Kisumu County. The event, dubbed Mashinani Empowerment, is her brainchild aimed at helping vulnerable girls in rural areas.
And this year, she thought of coming back home to empower the Mashinani girl child and boy child, and especially the focus on the girl child, where she was donating reusable sanitary pads, because in Seme, as we all know, there is high tendency of school dropout and high HIV prevalences. So we thought of bringing on board various career speakers who talk to the boys and girls and encourage them. And so we saw the need of coming here to empower them, and we really feel like that they have been empowered, and from here they are going to have comfortable lives in schools.
Achola Simon, Lifetime News.
And on news making headlines across borders, South Africa's power utility firm Eskom has put renewable energy projects at the core of bringing additional capacity to plug the electricity shortfall. Eskom says it is focusing on implementing all projects in order to meet the required 53 gigawatts of new additional energy for the period up to 2032, which will ensure energy security. Here are the details of this and other stories making headlines across Africa.
The power utility firm says the additional capacity will come from renewable energy sources and takes into account the current energy deficit of between 4,000 and 6,000 megawatts. This as South Africa continues to suffer repeated power blackouts, with Eskom struggling to keep the lights on. Eskom has confirmed the return of load shedding today. This after South Africans enjoyed a load shedding free weekend. South Africans have for the longest time been enduring relentless power cuts, thanks to load shedding. The load shedding stages have been varying between stages 2 and 6, with no end in sight to the country's electricity crisis. Eskom said stage 2 of the rolling blackouts will be implemented from 5 a.m. on Monday until 5 a.m. on Tuesday. Elsewhere, the Central Bank of Egypt has decided to liberalize the exchange rate and raise the interest rate by 2%. In an exceptional meeting of the Monetary Policy Committee, over the past 2 days, the price of Egypt's bonds offered in euros and dollars in foreign markets increased. The Central Bank of Egypt says the financing package that Egypt obtained is positive, but needs additional solutions to bridge the financing gap. Among the options being explored is foreign direct investment through the sale of state-owned assets as part of the strategy to exit some sectors for the benefit of the private sector. Finally, Ghanaian President Nana Akufo-Addo says his country is experiencing its worst economic crisis. The Ghana cedi has depreciated by over 50% this year and is listed as the world's worst performing currency against the US dollar. In a televised address to the nation, the president blamed speculations and illegal forex traders for the depreciation, adding that the central bank would clamp down on perpetrators. Fuel prices have been rising in the country and inflation has risen to a record 37.2%. To address the crisis, the president said the government would maintain a 30% cut in the salaries of the president, vice president, ministers, and other government appointees. Ghana is also negotiating a $3 billion IMF bailout program.
And now in the sports arena, former Black Stars captain John Mensah has urged the Ghanaian team to prioritize teamwork in order to attain their goals at the 2022 FIFA World Cup in Qatar. Ghana lost 3-0 to Brazil before beating bottom-ranked Nicaragua 1-0 during the international break. The World Cup finals will be exclusively televised live on KBC Channel 1 and on our the 20th of November through to the 18th of December 2022. World Cup, Echo KBC.
Former Black Stars captain John Mensah has urged Ghanaian team to prioritize teamwork in order to attain their goals at the 2022 FIFA World Cup in Qatar. The former Sunderland player said the team could achieve the country's target if they stick together. He also advised the team to treat the opening game with optimum importance because it will set a tone for the tournament. During the international break, Ghana lost 3-0 to Brazil before beating bottom-ranked Nicaragua 1-0.
A chance and look at that goal for Tawi Sawaku. Goal!
In Qatar, Ghana is in Group H alongside Portugal, South Korea and Uruguay. They'll begin their campaign against Portugal on 24th of November, followed by South Korea on 28th of November, and conclude their group matches against Uruguay on the 2nd of December.
Odegaard joining the attack. Martinelli holds it up. Now sends the ball over. Jesus, time to bring it down. Here's Odegaard. Still got it for Arsenal. Lots of tricks in there.
England begins their World Cup campaign in Qatar in less than a month, with Ghana's number 7 in contention to start their opening game against Iran, if fit. Meanwhile, Valencia striker Edison Cavani is set to be fit to join up with the Uruguay squad for 2022 World Cup despite an injury scare. The 35-year-old striker was forced off after just 18 minutes in Los Chess 1-0 La Liga defeat at home to Barcelona. The World Cup finals will be exclusively televised live on KBC Channel 1 and all KBC's radio stations beginning on 20th of November through to 18th of December.